I'm joined now by Kari Smilsky. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Now, for someone who is considering getting a CI, what are some things that they need to consider going into it?
I think the most important thing is that their motivation comes from themselves. They can't approach a cochlear implant because their spouse or family member wants them to get it. They really need to be at a place where they're struggling with their communication, they're withdrawing socially, and they really want to see some improvements in their ability to hear.
And I'm sure they come at you with loads of questions. What are some that they don't often ask that you kind of wish that they would?
Well, I think patients are hoping for sometimes a quick fix, and I think they need to recognize that getting a cochlear implant isn't like getting a pair of glasses where you put it on and you can hear instantly. There's a lot of work that needs to be done, some rehabilitation, and a lot of time and adaptation to get used to the sound.
Can you talk a bit about bilateral CI and the benefits associated with it?
The patients who I've worked with who've received bilateral cochlear implants, even those who were doing extremely well with one implant, can't express how much better it is with two. And I think we need to find better ways to quantify that improvement that a second implant can give.
How about structure preservation? Now, I don't know personally much about it, but what is it and how does that kind of play in with it?
So in the past 10 years, implants have really evolved to be much less traumatic, and the surgical techniques have evolved to be much less traumatic. So we're now able to preserve sometimes residual hearing and oftentimes the structure of the cochlea to lend itself to better outcomes.
If someone has just received a cochlear implant, what are the things that you tell them to kind of expect going forward?
I think patience is key. It's going to take time. I think that they need to be prepared to appreciate the small achievements that they make, and it's really an evolution from being able to detect sound in an ear that potentially couldn't hear anything previously to discrimination and being able to understand speech and recognize environmental sounds again, all the way up to music appreciation, which is something that we're starting to see with our implant patients.
What are you excited about personally at CI 2016?
I think it's a great opportunity to meet and mingle with colleagues from around the world and really see what everyone's working on. Particularly, I'm interested in some of the expanding criteria, some of the single-sided applications, patients who are getting implants with more and more residual hearing or perhaps bimodal hearing. I think that's a really exciting place to be moving forward to.
Certainly, and one last thing maybe quickly is hearing preservation. How important, when you're looking at CI options, how does this sort of play in?
I think it's becoming more and more important because as the criteria is expanded, we're assessing people with more and more residual hearing. And we know that if we can preserve some of that low frequency hearing, they potentially will hear better in noise, they'll have better music appreciation. They also will have some sound awareness in the evenings when they take their device off. So it's really important.
Wow. Thank you so much for joining us.
You're welcome.
And best of luck with the rest of the conference.
Thank you. Thanks very much.